meeting tonight, with the exception of Ivan Most, he'll be here in a few moments. I would ask the secretary to call a roll of the planning board.
Richard Tinsman.
Here.
Steve Netzel.
Here.
Judith Payne.
Here.
Janet McKay.
Here.
Gilman Angier. Thomas Emery.
Here.
Ivan Most.
Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4. Pending Mr. Most's arrival, chair will appoint Tom Emery as a voting member. First item of the agenda is the minutes of the previous meeting. Get a copy. Thank you. Are there any other comments, though, while I'm looking through on the minutes of the previous meeting?
I saw no changes.
Okay. On the Arnold Murray permit for replacement system, that was, as I remember, a 4-1 vote in favor, with the minutes indicating that I cast a dissenting vote. Did someone else vote against it that evening?
No.
I don't remember that either, and I didn't think that I voted against it.
That was the wastewater.
Wastewater.
I voted against it.
Okay. So if the minutes could be corrected to reflect that Tom Emery did vote against that and all others were in favor of it. Next item on page 7. At the end, for application completeness on the Jonesy Service Center application, the next to the last line indicates, or the third from the last line, indicates that the motion for application completeness was 3-2. That should read 3-1 in favor, Mr. Emery being opposed and Mr. Most abstaining, and the abstention vote would be a vote against it. One other. So with those corrections, is there a motion on the minutes of our April 17th meeting?
I move that the minutes be accepted as corrected.
It has been moved.
Second.
And seconded that the minutes be accepted of our April 17th, 1990 meeting as corrected. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Opposed? Unanimous vote. Welcome to our May 15th meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board. First item on the agenda is a public hearing for Joseph Higgins on a wetlands alteration permit for land that Mr. Higgins has off Wood Road. So we will open the public hearing and ask Mr. Higgins to present a 4 or 5 minute indication of what you propose to do on the site. If you could hold it so that members of the audience can see it as well. And if you could use the microphone, put it in front of you so that we can record your melodious discussion.
Mr. Chairman, I'd wish the record to reflect that Mr. Higgins is a neighbor of mine on Wood Road, and therefore I'd like to abstain from any discussion and voting in this matter.
Okay. Janet McKay will be abstaining on all discussion and voting on this matter. So we can both see it, both the audience and ourselves.
Okay. The drawing that you have before you is basically a contour map
which shows the proposed outline of the new lot, the proposed location of the building, the existing contours, and the existing drainage way. On the bottom, we have the right-of-way where both the sewer as well as the storm drain run through this right-of-way and back out towards Shore Road. Under the proposed alteration of the wetland, now the pink lines reflect the altered contours. The only real alterations are in the areas necessary to build the road over the right-of-way, as well as the contours around the house as proposed. This is a new drawing. There was a previous drawing which had inaccurate closure around the house, and as Mr. Emery brought up, and it has in fact been altered and now is more accurate as it is proposed here. Above the house, there's a proposed French drain to be installed in an effort to intercept surface and subsurface water, reroute it around the house and into the storm drain. There is one other small catch for where water could potentially accumulate at this point, where a small catch would be set and the line tied into the same point. Okay. Internal and external foundation drains will also be tied in to the same line approximately at this point as proposed. The only other line tie-in would be the sewer main, which we tied from the house here approximately to the manhole entrance there. We have manhole covered catch basins located at the turn in both locations here to make, you know, easy access.
Excuse me, I need to pull up one more map. It's impossible to tell the exact amount of footage that will end up in lawn in a situation such as this.
The alteration as proposed reflects the public access waiver section beyond the total width, average width of the road would be 650, which is in the dark. The main drive is 3,600 square feet as proposed. The house itself is 2,560 square feet approximately as proposed. And the buffer intended around it to go into lawn is approximately 4,840 square feet. And at this point in time, that is the plan. It exceeds the 5,000 square feet, but the proposal is not to, remove wetland vegetation or anything like that from the area. The area between here and the adjacent driveway is all pretty much grasses and would remain unaltered and as it is currently being used, possibly mowed. I'm, not sure at this point in time.
Okay. Thank you. Is that your presentation this evening?
Yes, sir.
Okay. This is a public hearing. The process of public hearing allows for public input on proposals before the planning board, and as a public hearing, we would solicit any comments that anyone might have in opposition or favoring a proposal before the planning board. Is there anyone that wishes to speak? Hearing and seeing none, I will close the public hearing and ask the planning board if there are any comments or questions.
Was there an upgraded grading plan submitted with the latest package?
Yes, there was. It should have been received in your package. It was just a one sheet, which showed the revised contour lines.
I didn't find one.
Any other comments or questions by planning board members? What are the wishes of the planning board?
I'd like to make a proposal.
Judith.
I propose that the planning board, I'm sorry, I messed up here. My motions. Okay, the planning board finds the wetlands alteration proposed by Joseph Higgins for one lot located off Wood Road meets the criteria of section 19-3-9 of the old zoning ordinance.
And the continuation of the motion, the order?
It therefore ordered that the request of Joseph Higgins for a planning board permit for wetlands alteration for one lot located off Wood Road be granted in accordance with section 19-3-9 of the old zoning ordinance and the facts presented.
Is there a second?
I'll second the motion.
Motion has been made and seconded as read. Any further discussion by members of the planning board? Mr. Emery.
I realize this is simply a single lot proposal, single-family residence, and it's not my desire to make this any more difficult or complicated than it has to be. But I do know enough about grading plans and house constructions, and again, this isn't, I'm not the town engineer, but the grading plan looks to me very problematic on a wet site. And it's my understanding that one way of dealing with subsurface drainage is to deal with it at the surface, so to speak. That is, as much water that you can channelize into swales and so forth and divert around a structure will tend to allow less groundwater dealing with a foundation. And I'm not satisfied that the grading plan really meets the criteria for doing that. It appears as most of the water is being drained across the property and directly toward the corner of the house, and other than the subsurface French drain, there's no swale defined around the perimeter of the house on either side. I guess the bottom line is that even if the owner is not concerned with what might come of this, there's a possibility that there's an increased area to be disturbed that isn't indicated on the plan. Nor on the plan do I have our proposed existing and proposed contours shown. So it's really not possible to determine how much area on the site is being disturbed.
Okay.
So given that, I can't support the application.
Very good. Any other comments on the motion?
Mr. Chairman, I think after being at the site and walking the site and reviewing the six items that the proposed alteration has to comply to, I really don't see any need or any reason to hold up the process any further. I see that within reason, all six of those items have been sufficiently covered.
Okay. Any other comments or questions? You're abstaining. I'll call the question then. All those in favor, please signify by raising your hand. Opposed? It's a 3-1 vote. Tom Emery in opposition, and Janet abstaining. You have your wetlands alteration permit. Good luck. Build a nice house and enjoy the Cape Elizabeth.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Next item on the agenda is Jonesy Service Center at 298 Ocean House Road. Two items discussing tonight. There's a request for a zone change from residential A district to a business A district. We'll have a public hearing on that. And the second item is a site plan review for the proposed changes to Jonesy's site. The process this evening will be that we will be having a public hearing on a zone change request. Following that public hearing and questions, the board can either vote to deny or recommend denial for a zone change request and submission of that to the council, or it can vote to recommend approval to the town council for a zone change, and that is the town council action. In addition to that, the planning board will be considering a site plan review, either approval or denial or tabling of the site plan review process. So with that, we will open a public hearing on the request for a zone change from residential A to a business district, business A district. Our public hearing would ask Mr. Jones to give us a short presentation on what you are proposing in the context of the zone change request.
At the last meeting, several issues were raised concerning our overall project, and I attempted to explain those in writing, and I don't believe it was that I read through the submission. But I do have, the most helpful thing I have with me is a couple of exhibits that might further explain and help visualize the overall project.
Greg, if on the issue of the zone change request, we could deal with the issue that specifically the zone change, and then after we close the public hearing, take action on that request, we'll be considering the site plan review issue, and then we'll get into some of the other things that we'll want to talk about.
This drawing helps show some of the plans for the grass area that we intend to install, and also give a pretty good idea of where the existing property line is and where the proposed new parking spaces would be around the perimeter. You'll notice that this is entirely new. This corner here is right now is just parking spaces and one light pole. We propose to grass that in this fashion and perhaps put some low shrubs in of some sort. Additionally, we intend to enlarge this center grass island out in the right-of-way and again put in some shrubbery and extend the curbing in both directions, this way and this way, in order to shrink up the distance between the entrance curbs. Additionally, we intend to grass in this area approximately 10 feet back from the new property line. In lieu of an additional parking space, we intend to grass it in and put curbing and have this act as a buffer and have it raised to a sufficient height so as to act as a visual screen of the parked cars in this corner especially. The only other plans are to leave along the perimeter to leave a swale of some sort to allow for the drainage. As far as the drainage goes, the two-thirds of the lot will drain to the back in this direction here because we have a natural slope in the grading anyways. The only concern I think that was expressed was near the front of the lot. We intend to, with the help of the Jim Murray, his crew, who will do most of the work, he intends to grade that to this swale here, and whatever water accumulates would run towards the ditch along 77, which is where most of our drainage goes now.
Greg, could you just turn that a little bit so all of our board members can see, and the audience? Thanks.
That's all I have on the zone change application.
Okay. Thank you. This is a public hearing, and like the last public hearing, its purpose is to solicit input from interested parties on a proposal that's before the planning board. The public hearing is open. I would ask for any comments that you might have on the proposal for Jonesy Service Center to, in its request for a zone change from Residence A to Business A districts. Hearing and seeing no requests for public input, we'll close the public hearing, and I'll ask the planning board if they have any questions or comments. Specifically on the zone change request, and then rather than calling for a vote, I think we should go right to the site plan review process, talk about the issues there, and hold the two votes as two separate votes, but on the same issue together. Any planning board members, any questions on the change or requested change for zone district boundary change?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Ritz.
Greg, the area that's looking to be changed, the zoning changed, is pretty much entirely going to be used for parking, is that right?
That's correct.
Yeah. The one boundary which would be to the right side, the upper right side, backs to an apartment house and a retail office. What's the zone? In other words, are you looking at a change in zoning at that location?
The
right there.
Business zone currently goes along our boundary here, across the back line, and then in behind his lot.
In behind, okay.
As I understand it. And then out to Shore Road, just beyond this next building here.
Your abutter of, to almost all of that line is whom?
This here?
Is that the church? No, the church?
Yeah, Methodist Church, yeah.
Any other questions or comments by board members on the zone change request? Hearing none. Greg, could you move then to a discussion of the site plan issues and what you propose to do on the site?
Well, I brought with me a rendering, if you will, that should help visualize the overall project. Don't be shocked by the brand. As I mentioned in my submission papers, there's a possibility that when this is said and done, we may not be Mobile Gas. Might be another brand. Texaco is one possibility. We use that for no other reason.
Have you come any closer in those discussions? You'd indicated in your letters that over the next few weeks that would be determined.
It's our intention to stay Mobile through a distributorship. I would say that the chances are better than 50-50 at this point that we would remain Mobile. For various reasons, we would like to stay that way after 42 years. And it would only come to another brand if none of the four area distributors could come to terms with us on our arrangements.
Okay.
This drawing was done with one visit and was not done on the site itself, and you'll see there's perhaps, especially on the perimeter, several inaccuracies. But it gives a general idea of the building and how it relates to the canopy, and it gives a good idea of size. Also, it shows the four dispensers underneath and the two columns we propose using, and also has the eight light units above. Again, this isn't entirely accurate, but does fairly well represent the, this will be new. Right now there's nothing here but a little bit of grass and dirt, and this curbing will be extended and grassed in, and as well as this one and the upper corner. But otherwise there aren't any changes. The bulk of the change is the addition of the canopy and also new dispensers underneath it, as well as some minor interior renovations to the showroom and office area.
Okay. Questions, comments by planning board members?
Mr. Chairman?
Tom?
I have a couple of questions. With respect to the grading plan, I wasn't able to make the site visit during the same weekend that other people did, but in looking at the area to the north where you're proposing to extend the parking lot, it appears on one of the plans that just simply is labeled slope pavement. Is that indicating that the pavement is to slope down toward the church?
This area here?
That's correct.
The left and rear would have some natural slope, but no more so than we already have on this half of the pavement. It would slope more to the back and to the side as opposed to down towards the front. That's what this notation indicates.
Let me ask a question, I guess, through Steve Butler. The plan I have shows, I have a survey plan that was prepared by HTA Ost Associates.
Yes.
It shows existing contours with, I believe, 1 foot intervals. And then I have a site plan that indicates a general configuration for the lot, but there's no layout information. There's no geometrics on that plan. And then I have preliminary building elevations with the Texaco logo. Is that my entire package?
That's your entire package for this meeting. Yes.
Okay.
There are a number of written documents as well.
I have that, too. Is it not a requirement of the ordinance that plans be prepared by professional individuals, whether it's engineers or architects or landscape architects? Is that a requirement to assure that sites drain properly and that there's no adverse impact on abutters?
While Steve's looking that up, let me answer from an old ordinance perspective. And I'm not sure whether that specific portion has been changed. The planning board has not required PE level drawings nor stamped or sealed signed drawings in the past, although that's something that some towns do, and our zoning ordinance may have been changed to reflect that. But if it hasn't been changed, this board has entertained and has acted on proposals before that allow this level of drawing to come before you.
Okay.
And Steve is looking at it to answer specifically your question.
Okay. Well.
And he has the answer.
It doesn't require that. I think the chairman's answer is correct. I mean, I think if certain technical aspects are desired by the board, it's at that point when that can be provided by an applicant. Sometimes an applicant provides it just as a matter of course.
Okay. The only reason I ask this is I said at the last meeting, I see Greg every day, and I think someone having excused themselves earlier, Janet, I think is indicative of it being a small community. Unless I get the reputation for being a bad actor over in the corner, I just always look at these applications with a neighbor coming up and saying, how in the heck did that thing ever get approval? And that's inevitably what we hear. And I also want to back it up with the idea that this is, we can have all of the comprehensive planning that we want, we can have Main Street 90, we can have all of these things, but essentially the character of the town depends upon the sort of incremental change that one taken at a time doesn't seem to do much, but over time, suddenly we've lost the character. And at the same time, Greg Jones owns this property and certainly has many rights in owning the property and certainly under the ordinance. So I'm taking all of those considerations simultaneously. Specifically to the plan in front of me, a concern I have is that in having seen the site actually rises up. As you get to the edge of the pavement, Greg, on the north side, it appears to rise up quite, I'm not going to say sharply, but there's a lot of irregularities due to the rock. Mm-hmm. And my best guess is that in order to grade the parking the way it's indicated on the plan, there's going to be a significant amount of ledge that's removed. And then toward the back of the property, there's a significant amount of fill that I believe is going to be required. And I'm questioning whether that, without a retaining wall or some other structure, whether you can really make that fill meet existing grade at the back without crossing that property line. And those aren't discoveries that I think it's easier to understand those implications prior to starting construction than it is during construction, and the only way I know of resolving those issues is by having someone prepare a document that will demonstrate that, a grading plan or whatever. And I don't know what the board is actually approving. That is not a big issue. But laying out curb radii and locating all of these various geometric items without any dimensions. We have a graphic illustration of it, but when someone goes into the field to approve this drawing, or if a planning board member goes by and see things differently than what we thought we were approving in the meeting, what recourse do we have? I mean, basically, do we literally slap a scale on the drawing and try to best depict that? So those are the concerns I have with respect there. I think there are impacts with blasting that's going to happen. I think there's going to be significant loss of some large trees in that area that really isn't being indicated on the drawing other than a line being shown, but there's nothing about large trees being removed. And lastly, I'm extremely concerned about the canopy, and I'll just reiterate the issues that I raised last time. One, there's a character in this section, this Pond Cove section, that has to do with Jonesy Service Station, and you made a comment last time that you're removing the blue canopy. I think the blue canopy with Jonesy's on it is sort of something that's very friendly and unique that differentiates Jonesy's from other service stations and other strip areas around the country. So I'm very concerned about the visual impact of the canopy, either physically in and of itself, and particularly at night with the bright illumination. I have read the comments, and I appreciate the comments about the lighting. There are ways also of determining light levels prior to construction, with various lighting engineers can provide that information. But I'm thinking ahead as well. As your sketch indicates, the building in the background, as one drives southerly on 77, starts to become blocked by the canopy. As if we were to take this ahead to the Irving Station, perhaps if they want to put a large canopy on, that's going to have immediate impact on the views of Town Hall from 77. And then the last in the trilogy, of course, would be Cumberland Farms. And at that point, what we have is three service stations in downtown Cape Elizabeth, so to speak, all brightly illuminated. And essentially what we've gone is from a neighborhood or a downtown center into another strip area that's more indicative of off-highway, near highway exits than it is of what I think of more downtown areas. So that's very subjective. I don't know if there's anything in the site plan ordinance that I can directly hinge that on. I could just say that from a more technical standpoint, I'm concerned about the grading, the removal of existing vegetation, and impacts, visual impacts of the canopy and light levels.
Thank you. And let me also ask that you remain as a voting member through this issue, with Mr. Most then picking up with the next full item that he is here for the discussion on. Any other members of the planning board wish to question or comment?
Mr. Chairman.
Steve.
Greg, did you have any further input? At the sidewalk, we were trying to determine some of the ingress, egress of the sites, and the concern at that time, and I don't think it's reflected on the prints that we have in front of us, the reduction of the size of the exits entrances down to 36 feet, which...
That's correct. When these were done, as well as the packet you have before you, I did not have this letter from Mr. Hunter. He indicates that it would be advisable to narrow these both entrances to a maximum of 36 feet. If that be required, it would be amenable to us if that were a factor that was involved with the approval process.
It also, if you remember...
No, it's not indicated. You're right. Yeah. It's not indicated here or... these distances are more in line with the existing.
I mentioned last Saturday that you might check with Bob O'Malley. Is it O'Malley? O'Malley. O'Malley. From a public works standpoint, you have quite a leeway. You have sizable openings now. Which way would be most feasible, to move it away from the current major intersection of the 5 or 10 corners there? Back. I think to a certain extent, visually, that will be a great improvement. To a certain extent, I agree with Mr. Emery. However, at the same time, we have three gas stations in the center of town, and gas stations look like gas stations. I think you're proposing an attractive site. There's a concern. You mentioned also that some of the ledge, which you realize is a great deal of, or suspect there's a great deal of ledge, will be taken out and moved actually to that back line to steepen the slope. Is that right?
Yeah, that's correct. That's what Mr. Murray indicated, that the ledge from the side could be used in the back, and if any additional was required, of course, it's available on his location.
Also at that sidewalk, concern of mine from the drainage we talked about, from the canopy itself, the drainage doesn't increase, it just simply concentrates when you have the downspouts through the standards, I believe. I'd like to see on the site plan how the sheeting, once it hits the pavement there, we talked about making sure that it goes out the lower, or the northwesterly side, I guess it would be, and not get dammed up behind that peninsula coming out, and that it goes down the ditch of the state route, or the route 77. Additionally, I guess the only other comment that I would have is in walking around your building, presently, you can sort of drive a car around it, but the boundary is very limited on the, what would be the north or the east of the corner. I think we need to keep that in mind in reviewing the site as well. I have no further questions.
Thank you, Mr. Edsel. Also, I would point out that to Mr. Emery's questions earlier, that the drafted motion for the site plan review process recognizes a number of things that still need to be done and to be shown to the town engineer and town planner, code enforcement officer, whatever the case may be, on specific items of interest and further detail to give it more of the definition that would be required prior to implementation. So all board members might want to review that as well. Other comments by planning board members?
I have a question for
Judith
Greg.
King.
Am I on? Yeah. When I was out at the site walk on Saturday, we were talking about the 36-foot mm-hmm. openings. Do you have any feeling where we were talking about where the 36 feet would be? Either they could be here or there. What was your feeling? I've been thinking about
well,
that.
Well, the only thing we were somewhat in agreement on was to extend this curb here to move the entrance further down from the intersection. Of all the problems we have, I'd say the most important one is people coming out of Shore Road at the same time somebody's exiting our lot mm-hmm. and them not seeing each other. I think if we move this down further, that would help alleviate some of that concern. So I would probably attempt to keep this where it exists right now and bring this down, this triangular area down to a sufficient footage to accommodate the 36-foot width. Down below, again, it doesn't matter much to me. My guess was, from an appearance standpoint, it would make sense to extend both this curbing and this one, and therefore shrink it in kind of a symmetrical nature, and have 36 feet between the two curbs.
But no feel, and I've thought about if you had it more northerly, the opening more northerly, would, I was trying to visualize how it would look with the canopy to have a bigger island.
Well, down here?
Yeah, moving it that way. Then wondering if you push it out too far, would it be hard with the cars going in and out or to bring in a wrecker? Would it be too tight with people at the pumps? I know you call them dispensers, but they're
yeah, if you bring this too far down, it would create a zigzag effect, people coming in and having to swerve around to get in line with the islands. As far as the trucks go, I haven't been able to reach them at the plant, but I'm assuming that the new tanks will be in this position as what the current ones are. And as far as access in the 36-foot width, I don't think that'll be a problem.
The only other question or comment I had was to the buffering that you were proposing on the peninsula coming out of the Methodist Church side is to make sure that somehow you reach the balance between having a good buffer but not blocking sight lines,
mm-hmm.
which goes, of course, without saying.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Other planning board comments and questions? There are then, I will call for a motion by the planning board. There are two proposed orders before you. I would like to take them one at a time. One deals with a recommendation to the town council for a zone change request. The second proposed order is for site plan approval or consideration. What are the wishes of the board?
Mr. Chairman, I'll move that the planning board recommends to the town council the requested zone change from a residence A district to a business A district for land bordering Jonesy Service Center located at 298 Ocean House Road in accordance with section 19.4.9 of the zoning ordinance.
Motion has been made.
Second.
And seconded. Everyone understand the motion? Any further discussion on the motion?
One quick question.
Judith.
When it says that land adjacent, adjoining, whatever, Should it be more specific to mean only the 30-foot strip? Or do we know what we're talking about? I don't want it to all of a sudden include more than that.
The requested zone change, there's evidence before us and testimony and documentation, so that should be sufficient. Any other comments or questions? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Opposed? Unanimous decision. The next proposed order deals with the site plan review process.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Edson.
Before we make any motion, I just want to be clear in my own mind. It looks like what's before us. Either we propose a motion that has a number of conditions, or we simply ask the applicant to come back with all of those conditions changed or altered. I guess that's our decision. Do we look at a motion that has a lot of conditions? I guess conceptually I haven't had a chance to really get a good sense of what they're all going to look like.
Does the board wish to have a few minutes to review the conditions that have been suggested by the planner?
I'd like to.
Okay. With the board's permission, I'll call a 5-minute recess. Take the time to take a look at the conditions that have been suggested, and the board is in recess. Call the planning board back into a session. Now that you've had a chance to look at the conditions and determine how you wish to proceed on this item, the chair awaits.
Was he in the middle of a motion?
I think he's in the middle of comment.
I ended my comment.
Okay.
I'm not in the middle.
What are the wishes of the board?
Mr. Chairman, just one comment that was pointed out, a technical item under suggested condition B. Talks about 35 feet, that should be 36 feet. It's a typo.
Unless the board wanted it 35 feet.
Yes.
Questions or comments, or what are the wishes of the board?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman.
Try to be concise. I think the review process is always an onerous one for everyone, and I hate to see someone who goes through the process only to be sort of unrewarded by being dragged through a number of meetings. But I have some basic concerns. I think in the long run may make things easier for Greg if he has more definitive engineering information, configurations, traffic circulation, the idea of whether that north entrance should be a little further north or a little further south, and cars swinging into the islands and so forth. At least in my experience, under difficult situations like that and at the intersection configuration, it's not unusual at all to have sort of dashed lines that indicate traffic movements for various vehicle types. I think we should know what plant materials he's proposing on the berm and the height of the berm relative to the height of the street. I think there's just quite a bit of technical information that's not available to us that I would certainly like to see, although we have certainly a competent town engineer. I would personally like to have the opportunity to see it. Therefore, I would propose that we table this until we have an opportunity to review additional information.
Is that a motion?
It's not a motion, but it's, if someone could help me put it in the form of a motion, I'd like it to be one. I would move that we table this application and until such time that Greg is able to bring to us more definitive geometric information on the layout, grading that, if nothing more than spot elevations that indicate how the surface is to slope, and plant material and the height of the berm, and an overall drainage plan.
Motion has been made to table. Motion for tabling allows no discussion. If it is seconded, then we will move quickly into the vote then. Is there a second on the motion to table?
I second.
It's been moved and seconded to table Jonesy's Service Center application for site plan approval, pending a number of considerations that were brought up in the tabling motion. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Opposed? It's a 4-1 vote. Mr. Jones, we'd ask that you come back at a subsequent meeting with the requested information defined on the plans. The 4-1 vote was with myself as opposed.
Is there any way we could have a public hearing on this? I, as a board member, am very torn on how I feel about the canopy. From this one side where I pump my own gas, I would love to have it when it's raining. To the other side of the precedent of having that, I would like to know how other people in the community feel about it before I can make a knowledgeable vote on it.
Public hearing is allowed for site plan review process under our own ordinances. That is an option for the board to take if it so desires. I would ask the town planner, how was the public hearing noticed for the zone change request? Was there any indication of a site plan amendment as well?
Yes. The notice was put in a newspaper, and it was also sent out to all the surrounding abutting property owners. We go beyond just the strict abutting and adjacent property owners. And it was in reference to a zone change with respect to land around it, and I believe it mentioned the canopy and the additional parking.
So it did mention the canopy.
I could double check, okay, though.
And frankly, I would love to have the Cape Elizabeth to turn out and say, you know, give Greg the canopy. But I just want to know how people feel.
Double check.
Okay, Steve is checking that, and before we leave this item then, because it may be appropriate to, if the board wishes to have a public hearing, to set a public hearing, I would suggest, though, that if there's any indication in the public hearing announcement for the zone change request, that may have been sufficient notice for
those who might be interested. If no one
showed up. That's correct.
And I know how they feel.
And only because we've already called a recess, I won't call another one while we're waiting for Steve to get back. Go on a meeting of recesses. Is Greg still here? Greg, while you're still here and while we're waiting for Steve to get back, was there any confusion that you felt about the board? Do you have a pretty good feel for the information that's necessary for the board to take action? Okay. Mr. Butler.
Mr. Chairman, actually the notice did not mention the canopy. It mentioned the zone change request from BA to Residence A along two sides of the property. That's all I mentioned. Did not mention the canopy.
Okay. What are the wishes of the board?
My wish is to have a public hearing.
Is that a motion?
I move that we have a public hearing on the site plan review, specifically mentioning the canopy.
The date of the June meeting is? Probably would be June 19th. At 7:05. Motion has been made. Is there a second?
Second motion.
Motion has been made and seconded to hold a public hearing on the site plan application for Jonesy Service Center on June 19th, 1990 at 7:05. Any further discussion? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor, please signify by raising your hand. Opposed? A 3-2 vote for a public hearing with Mr. Edsel and Janet McKay is opposed. Motion passes. There will be a public hearing 7:05 here on June 19th. Next item on the agenda is Sherwick Woods, a proposed 17-lot major subdivision by Edward Drynan, extending off Chevish Road and Macaulay Roads. Issued tonight is preliminary plan review, a public hearing, conformance with Section 16.2.4 of the subdivision ordinance. With that in mind, this is our third public hearing this evening. Purpose of the public hearing, once again, for those who weren't here earlier, is to solicit public comment on a proposed application before the town planning board. The rules of the public hearing are that the applicant will make a short presentation on what is proposed, and that interested parties are asked to come forward, use the microphone, identify themselves, where they live, and make the comments as they desire, holding to the issue at hand of the proposed subdivision plan. With that, we'll ask Mr. Drynan to make a short presentation on the proposed application.
Is this readily visible to the members of the board?
Yes, it is.
My name is Edward Drynan. I'm here to talk about Sherwick Woods. Under the State of Maine Growth Management Law and the Town of Cape Elizabeth Comprehensive Plan, certain areas of our town are designated as rural areas and others as growth areas. The 24.5-acre Sherwick Woods proposal before you tonight is designated as both a growth area and an infill growth area. The reasons for these designations as growth and infill growth are that it is well suited for development, there is an absence of major natural resource features, it is flanked by three existing neighborhoods, and the presence of public water and sewer at the site. The comprehensive plan has as one of its goals the preservation of open space. This proposal will create two open space parcels totaling about 8 acres, or about one-third of the total land. These open spaces will prevent any new construction from being seen by most abutters. Those of you who have taken the site walk, if you recall from standing on the individual house sites proposed, you couldn't see out to the existing neighborhoods, and the existing neighborhoods couldn't see in to the actual houses. Where I have not been able to donate a large amount of land as open space as part of this project's sensitivity to abutters, I have put in place thickly wooded and heavily treed buffer zones and placed building windows far from sidelines. This project has been specifically designed to protect and preserve environmental concerns. Wetlands have been mapped. They're located here, 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 and here. The proposed fill of wetlands for road construction on the entire 24-acre site is less than one parking bay in your average two-car garage. Those of you on the sidewalk did not get your feet wet anywhere along the proposed road, including the wetland crossing, and this is about the wettest time of the year. Speaking of proposed roads, I'd like to remind the board and any concerned members of the public that the present road layout is possible for three reasons. One, the planning board, abutters, and I did not want to disturb wetlands more than necessary. The planning board and members of the nearby neighborhoods on Sherwick Ave and Chevris and Macaulay Road absolutely did not want a cut-through road. The cut-through road would have run from Sherwick Ave, wound its way through the site, and wrapped around Macaulay out to Leiden Lane. Considerate of those abutter and board concerns, I've arranged to spend a significant amount of money to satisfy the concerns of abutters regarding road access. The present road has less impact on abutters than any possible alternative. Continuing for a minute on road impacts, traffic engineer Bill Bray is here tonight and will respond to any concerns the board or the public may have. Among the facts he is prepared to say is one that interests me more than others, since I live on Mitchell Road. I was alarmed to see in a letter from some of the abutters to this project that their claim that 6 years ago Mitchell Road had reached 90% of capacity. This is simply wrong, and it's based on bad information and a seven-year-old report that our town engineer labeled as poorly presented, quite confusing, and using a term tolerable traffic levels as one which is not recognized by traffic engineers. In 1992 or 3, when all the projects presently approved and in the planning process, all those projects contemplated to put traffic on Mitchell Road are fully built out. Traffic should not exceed, at that time, 70% of level of service A, which is the highest and best use. Percentage of allowable capacity on Mitchell Road, of course, will be far less than is allowed. Now, those of us who live on Mitchell Road and drive on Mitchell Road know that it is not the volume of traffic that concerns us, but the speed of some of the traffic when combined with some tight curves on a poorly designed road. Our town is a green belt system. A goal of the comprehensive plan is to expand the green belt system when a development is in the planning stage. This proposal is literally crisscrossed with new additions and new links to the green belt system. You can draw an X through the project and you'll find your green belt linkages. Regarding density, some abutters have in a letter to the planning board requested a serious compromise on the issue of density, suggesting lesser scale, bigger lots, less lots, and more expensive lots. I've responded to those concerns. The scale has been tremendously reduced by the single access entry from Chevres Road and developing only two-thirds of the land. The lots are bigger, more than half again as big as zoning requires. This land is zoned for 52 housing units. I'm proposing 17. That's what I call less lots, and that's what I call scaled back. As to those abutters who want to see more expensive lots, well, that speaks, I think, for itself. Regarding waste disposal, the 17 lots will be served by a combination of public sewer to lots 11 and 12, on-site septic systems on lots 7, 8, 9, 10, 13, and 14, and a common system servicing the remaining 8 lots, 1 through 5 and 15, 16, and 17. All the waste disposal systems meet state and local plumbing codes. You know it's my desire to see public sewer in all the lots, and I think it's the public, the abutters' desire to see public sewer on the lots, and I think it's the planning board's desire. We know that the sewer committee has unanimously endorsed this board's recommendation that the planning board, with the consent of the town engineer and the public works director, be allowed to approve sewer to a development proposal which will occur with or without sewer. I hope the town council acts expeditiously. If the project is totally sewered, the number of lots will remain the same, 17. There will be a slight reconfiguration of the lot layout, which in my opinion will turn a good plan into a great one. Lots 5 and 6 will be combined into one lot. Lots 11, 12, and 13 will be combined into two lots.
Ed, could you point those out on the drawing?
Lots 5 and 6 right here. Those of you on the sidewalk recall that there is a wetland there. And there was question not only concerning the fill of that wetland for the house development, but access to lot number 6, whether we're going to come in low by the wetland or up here by the cul-de-sac. If the project is sewered and the number of lots remains at 17, I will make lots presently designated as 5 and 6 one lot. Easy access and a much bigger building, easily located building window out of the wetland. If the project is sewered, lots 11, 12, and 13, those on the sharp curve where some grading would be required on the downside will be reduced from 3 lots to 2 lots. And the large area now designated as the common septic system would be split to form 2 lots. The total remains 17. The layout and lot configuration and actual house siding, much better. Relatively speaking, I got the impression that some members of the planning board thought lots 5 and 6 and possibly 12 are marginal lots. I think in the context of the entire site and the beautiful lots that do exist there, they may be relatively marginal, but for a building lot, I think they're good lots. This, however, would make them very good lots. To summarize, I'd like to say this is a new neighborhood. It's modest in size, about one-third the scale of what zoning allows. This is a proposal that will not only maintain the market values of the existing surrounding properties, but enhance them. And I think it's a proposal which provides a thoughtful consideration of environmental impacts on wetland, timber stands, open spaces, and abutting landowners. With me tonight is traffic engineer Bill Bray and civil engineer Rick Light from Land Use Consultants, and we'll be happy to answer the public and the board's concerns or questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Drymond. This is a public hearing, and we'll open it up for public comment now. All interested parties come forward and make your comments on the proposed plans. Yes, sir.
Okay.
If you could identify yourself and...
Shelley. Members of the board, my name is Jack Lustig. I am a resident of Kildare Road, off Mitchell. I am not in favor of this project, but neither am I opposed. I am concerned. I have been a resident of the area for many, many years. I have no prepared speeches or nothing that I wrote down before, but just tonight. First of all, regarding water in the area, having walked that area for 27 years already, to say that there is no water problems there could be a little bit of a shading of a truth. There is water problems there. Living on Kildare Road like I do, we're quite a distance. We do not have a totally dry area. On a heavy rain, there is water, even up into our back property, which we call our back lawn. So to say that it is absolutely safe and there are no problems, I just cannot buy. I would like to know if the board or the members or the owners of the property have addressed the wildlife displacement in there. We, as residents of the area, have noticed a considerable amount of wildlife displacement ever since the Cranberry Project is built there. We have had our shrubbery cleared out a couple of winters already, right up to our foundation planting by the wildlife. I don't know if this is normal, having lived on the property all these years and nothing ever happened, but it is happening ever since the development way back there. This year, the wife and I will be spending a considerable sum of money just replacing all of our foundation and off-foundation plantings that we have in our backyard because they were cleared out by deer this year. Traffic. This is something, Mitchell Road. Mitchell Road has not been changed since we've been living there. The amount of homes that use Mitchell Road, I would probably say have quadrupled since we have moved in there. It is a concern. I don't think it is speed. I think it is volume. And if any of you people have used Mitchell Road early in the morning and seen those school buses try to get out of Chevres, it is a wait of anywhere between 5 to 8 minutes until they could clear themselves to turn into to Mitchell Road from Chevres. And that is not due to speed, that is due to volume of traffic. And we are not through with the volume of traffic on Mitchell Road because all the houses that have been approved are not yet built or are not yet sold. The police department, I'm gonna pose this as a question. Has the police department been surveyed about the number of incidents, warnings that they have given out in recent years what degree of increase has it been over the past 3 to 5 years of their problems on Mitchell Road due to traffic. Another thing that I am deeply concerned with as a citizen and resident of Cape Elizabeth is the comment that I just picked up about septic tanks in the area, partially sewered, partially septic tanked. I thought this was a matter of history as far as Cape Elizabeth was concerned, approving septic tanks in areas where there is even a hint of a water problem. The big thing that concerns me with this septic tank business is once the developer has sold the homes, received his money, and left the scene and smiles, what guarantee does this planning board, does this town of Cape Elizabeth and the taxpayers of Cape Elizabeth have that there will be 10 years down the line no petitioning of 17 homeowners or however many that are going on septic tanks, that they are being discriminated against, they are having cellar problems, they are having odors coming up through their systems and petitioning this town for hundreds of thousands of dollars of additional expenditure to pull them out of a mess that could have been created. I'm wondering how far in depth we have gone on this, and if it is approved, and I am not an engineer, I am nothing more than a humble peddler who is making a living, if it is approved, I would like to know what guarantees does my town have against spending money 10, 15 years down the line for a mistake that somebody made. If the engineers feel this strongly about the system, how long will they guarantee us that it will not produce any problems? And that is my main concern. It's traffic, it's safety, and it's the environmental catastrophe that could happen within this area. I thank you for your time listening to me.
Thank you, sir. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Deborah Vallely, and I live right here. My main concern also is the traffic in that area. I was one of the people that, along with 14 other residents, sent a letter to the planning board with the engineer study dated 1983 from Hunter Ballou Associates. And as far as Mr. Drynan's comments that this traffic study is not maybe concise, this is what the planning board at that time used for their recommendation for the development. I think that Mitchell Road is very saturated. Chevis Road was a small neighborhood, made larger with our development, made even larger with this new development, and I have serious concerns about the traffic. The other thing I was wondering is, a question for the planning board or for Mr. Drynan. As far as the timber stance and the wetlands, what role does the DEP play in a development of this size? As far as, does it go past the DEP for approval, or is that something that isn't seen? I was under the impression that over 20 acres, even if some of the land is donated, would have to have DEP approval. It's something I was just curious about. And the sewer, of course, the septic tanks, I'm not for. I think that down the road that could present a real problem to the neighborhood. Who's going to take up the slack in years to come if they have to be turned over to sewer? Is that the taxpayers? Do they have to take up some of that? So these are just concerns I'd like to address.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. My name is Jim Lemieux. I represent Kevin Gildard of 47 Macaulay Road. He was unable to make it here tonight because he's out of town on business. He has asked me to read a letter to the board that he's prepared and to make some additional comments. Dear board members, I wish to take this opportunity to to express some concerns I have related to Mr. Drynan's proposed subdivision. I am somewhat surprised that consideration will be given to allow a property originally designated to be a house lot and have it proposed or changed to support a road. I am not familiar with lot restrictions, but I do know that I was led to believe the subdivision I built in was intended to be laid out as house lots and not for a right-of-way for a road. I am a little disturbed that now that we have built and settled in, that one lot not built on can be changed to a roadway. I feel very much misled by this part of the process and would hope that we don't mislead others in the future. However, my primary concerns are of much more importance to safety and health rather than subdivision regulations. The first issue to be addressed. I believe there has been no groundwater study accomplished to date. My concern is that a septic system is proposed. My property has a drainage easement on the back line. It is a free-running spring 11 months out of the year. The drainage appears to come from groundwater in the proposed development area. I am concerned that the water may become contaminated from the septic system in its normal operation, and there is a higher potential if the septic fails, which is not an unlikely event. I would suggest it to be prudent for the board to require a groundwater study accomplished by professional engineers to determine the flow and likelihood of groundwater, including springs, runoffs, well water, or pond water, and groundwater contamination as a result of a proposed septic systems or system included in this project. I would also suggest that it would be prudent of the board and the town council, if need be, to delay any approval of this development until such time as the appropriate sewer hookup is available. With the issues of pollution and the environment being as sensitive as they are today, it may be time for development to wait for the proper technology, i.e. sewer treatment versus undependable technology of septic systems. The board is unable to see its way to that position. I would suggest that a very specific requirement be established to require the septic system be managed by a homeowners association, monitored by the town's safety and public health officials to ensure that the system is operating and maintained properly. In addition, if the association is not formed properly, this development should not be allowed to proceed. I'm also concerned about the issue of safety as it is related to my family and my neighbors due to the length of the road or roads proposed and the waivers requested, particularly as it relates to fire apparatus, ambulance, and police vehicles. At this time, there's only one way in and out of the Cheverus McCauley area. The proposal seeks to aggravate this already undesirable situation and seems to run contrary to the safety concerns of the police and fire chiefs of the town of Cape Elizabeth, in addition to making an already unsafe intersection, Mitchell and Cheverus, more unsafe, an issue the board has been aware of for several years. I would also like to raise my concerns about project completion. In today's market, I find it at least curious that this project makes financial sense. My specific concern being the developer's ability to complete the minimum improvements prior to selling the necessary number of lots. I would request that the board assure itself, whether through bond or some other instrument, that roads and utilities be completed by a reasonable date, regardless of the sale of lots and construction of houses, in order to avoid the creation of an eyesore and a hazard as a result of poor financial condition of the market. Other issues I have concerns about, but may not be as onerous as those I've mentioned above, are proper buffer for all abutting properties, including town-owned properties, compatibility of design to existing neighborhoods, disruption of existing traffic flow due to construction, as well as the safety of children and animals during the construction process. The intent of this letter is not to prevent or hinder Mr. Drynan from developing his land. Quite to the contrary, I only ask that all parties be given fair and equal treatment, and any development in this area be accomplished in strict accordance with town requirements and with due consideration to the safety and health of the citizens of Cape Elizabeth, with a keen eye towards taking the bold steps required to protect such a sensitive environment as the one we are fortunate enough to live in. Thank you for your time and consideration. Sincerely, Kevin B. Gildart, 47 McCauley Road. As to my own concerns, I'm concerned as to what plan we're reviewing tonight. Are we reviewing the plan of January 29th, 1990, or the plan of May 9th, 1990?
January 29th, whatever was proposed for public hearing.
Okay, so this additional proposal of separate septic systems and town sewer is not before the board tonight.
The applicant presented this evening that the original plan stands, okay. That's what we're here for.
So I guess then Mr. Gildart's comments are directed towards the correct plan. Also concerning, specifically for Mr. Gildart's property, concerning the buffer, The preliminary subdivision plan indicates that there'll be no buffer on the town of Cape Elizabeth property, right along here. And then it indicates a buffer of only 15 feet along the Gildot property. I guess his request is, what we're doing is we're giving a 30-foot buffer for all the properties on Kildare Road, and his, of course, concern is, why is he only get a 15-foot buffer? The other suggestion that we're making is, at that corner of the property, as you can see, there will be no, well, you can't really see it from this distance, but there's a point where he'll have no buffer at the southeasterly corner of Lot 1. And I guess this would be the most westerly corner of the Gildot property. As you can see, it just comes to a point, so that you would actually have a situation where there would be zero buffer right along that point. You following me, Steve? What we'd suggest, and I think that it would not be a great change, would be one, to increase this to 30 feet to have it be the same as everybody else, and also to extend it approximately 20 or 30 feet to the abutting the Cape Elizabeth property, so that there is an actual buffer throughout. Also, there's a note on sheet 3 of the high intensity soil survey which states that the soil mapping was done with snow cover on the ground, and that there may be subtle soil changes that were not detected due to the inability to observe vegetative understory, low relief bedrock, outcropping, and subtle drainage swales and watercourses. I guess the question is, has the planning board or the planning department required Mr. Dryan's engineers, land use consultants, to review the soil this spring to check for undetected watercourses or drainage swales going towards the abutting properties? I guess that's all I have to
okay,
say.
Thank you very
thank
much.
You.
I'm sure the applicant would like to address some of those issues. Other comments or questions as part of the public hearing process this evening? Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, my name is Debbie Peary. I'm a resident, new resident of Kildare Road, of only 3 days. And so, in all fairness to Mr. Drynan and to the board, I have not yet had time to do my homework. But I just would like to underscore the concerns brought forward by my neighbors, and particularly Mr. Gildart and Mr. Lustig, and concerning the water, the moistness of the area, the traffic, and the septic, proposed septic sewage problem there. Specifically for our property, there is a question for me, a concern for me, of the buffer proposed by Mr. Drynan. I am beginning to learn about the greenbelt system here in Cape Elizabeth. But I would like to know what guarantee we as property owners would have that this buffer zone would be respected by the owners, the new owners of the property once it is sold, parcel is sold out. We have behind us a nice lot of land where there are a great number of large trees, and I would hate to see them removed by new property owners. It would be really a travesty. And one point Mr. Drynan pointed out was that we could not see on this. I was there on the sidewalk on Saturday as my husband was moving into our new house. And in the middle of the proposed road at one point, I could see my house. So it is visible. Some of the other subdivisions are visible from the middle of this. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Other members of the, hold on. Are the members of the public? Yes, sir.
Hi, my name's Matt Monroe. I live next to the Gildharts on 46 Macaulay Road, or also known as Lot 2. I have a couple of concerns. I can tell you from living down there for the last 4 years, it's wet. My backyard right now, if you walk in it, you're going to get up to your ankles. It's wet. And if we're going to add sewers into these houses, where's that groundwater going to go? I'm very, very concerned about that. Also, as a new parent, I'm concerned about the increased traffic into our neighborhood. To me, I'm very, very concerned. And also, it's my understanding, and after walking the lot, these have to be some of the nicest woods in Cape Elizabeth, with some of the oldest pine trees. how many of these are we going to lose? One of the nicest pine trees on the whole development is right in the middle of where the proposed road is, and we're subject to losing that. I'm also concerned about the impact on the wetlands, especially lots 5 and 6, and the road going over the wetlands and alteration of the wetlands by the road. So those are some areas that I have of concern. And I also have some concern during the construction as to the initial width of the road. Is there going to be a large sign like we saw at Stonegate? Are we going to have people driving in and out of their construction vehicles? I'm real concerned about the safety of the children in the neighborhood.
Thank you, sir. Any other comments, ma'am?
Mr. Chairman and members of the Planning Board, my name is Deborah Friedman, and I live at 72 Spurwink Avenue, which I believe is right here. And I think a lot of people here tonight have raised some of the technical concerns, which I think you as a Planning Board and your planner are more capable than I am of figuring out, and I have the impression that this board is very deliberative about development, so I have faith that you will take care of those particular concerns. But I do want to say that I really appreciate the time and effort that Ed Drinan has taken with me and my neighbors on Spurwink Avenue, and I think with some of the other abutting neighbors, to have meetings and to hear our concerns and to try to make some very nice buffers. And I think we on Spurwink Avenue probably have the best buffer of anybody around the development. We have that land that would be dedicated as the wetlands property. So I really appreciate that, and I just wanted to maybe make some counteracting comments that I think some care has been taken to address concerns of the abutting landowners. And I think some of the issues that people raised tonight are valid concerns, and I do have faith that the Planning Board will look into those very carefully before they approve the subdivision. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Any other comments? Ma'am, did you have another comment? Could you identify yourself again for the record?
I just, Deborah Vallely, I just wanted to say on another note, I took the site walk on Saturday also, and as Debbie had previously said, from Kildare Road, from standing where one of the proposed house lots are, I can see the back of my house quite clearly, so I just
okay.
Wanted to.
Thank you. Any other comments? Yes.
My name is Mark Dennison. I live at 64 Spurwink Avenue, which is one house down from Debbie Friedman, the other side, where Ed has proposed right away to go in for the open space land. I only have two problems with the whole project, and that is the proposed land that he'd like to give to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. Whatever they have for a right away off from Spurwink Avenue, I would like to see that marked so people know where they can walk down through there, because I, as a property owner, would not like to be responsible if someone fell on the property down there. And the only other thing I have is the septic system. I lived at 64 right now, but I lived at 63 all my life. I've been a resident for 28 years in the town of Cape Elizabeth. I played on the majority of all this property as a kid growing up. And the area behind me is extremely wet. That brook there is a natural runoff from Ken Maxwell's farm pond behind his farm. And the land that Ed Drinan has proposed to build most of the houses on is a lot of ledge. And what ain't ledge is swamp. And I would just like to see the town, if they do pass it, sewer the whole project. That's all I have.
Thank you. Any other comments or questions? Public hearing process. Hearing none, we'll close the public hearing then on the...
Mr. Chairman?
Yes?
Were we going to allow the developer to comment under public hearing, or are we going to wait till afterwards?
As part of the comment process rather than public hearing process.
Okay.
Originally tonight, too, we had anticipated holding the public hearing process open pending another meeting. As Mr. Drinan had previously indicated, that there may be changes in the plan beyond what was presented this evening. My understanding, the presentation is that the plan will look essentially as it is. There will be no other land proposed to be added to it. and that the issue then relates and centers on possible public sewering of the property if there are any changes that will occur. Therefore, it's not expected that we will be continuing the public hearing tonight. In terms of the public hearing now being closed, the applicant is free to make comments if you wish. The planning board will also be asking questions of Mr. Drinan as an applicant. Notwithstanding the issues that are discussed tonight, the issues that have been raised during the public hearing process are good issues. They're issues that beg answers and require the applicant and the planning board to search for the answers to a variety of questions. And again, notwithstanding what's discussed tonight in response to those questions, I would expect that some of the issues may require further review by the applicant. And anticipating that the planning board would not be acting tonight on the proposed application, that this board will want to see answers to all of those questions that will be reflected in our minutes, and I'm sure that you've taken your own notes and will be prepared to answer those questions. So I would offer Mr. Drinan a few moments to comment on issues that came up during the public hearing, or you can defer commenting on those issues until our subsequent meeting.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman, and the members of the public who spoke. I'd like to bounce around just briefly and ask Debbie Perry if you live in the old Finley House? I'd also like to ask the chairman if you anticipate asking further questions and concerns of the board tonight of us.
We do.
Would you like us to address the concerns of the public at this time?
I think that would be appropriate.
I'm going to ask Bill Bray, a traffic engineer, to comment on any comments made relative to traffic.
Good evening. I'm not sure that I have them all, but I'll try to.
Bill, for the record, too, could you identify yourself for both?
Yes, my name is William Bray. I'm a registered professional engineer in the state of Maine, and my primary practice is in the field of traffic and transportation engineering. One of the issues that was discussed was the increase in traffic on Chevres Road and the increase in traffic along Mitchell Road. As indicated in the report that was prepared for this project, the present morning traffic flow on Chevres is 57 vehicles, and that's a two-way volume on the street, and during the evening peak hour that volume increases to 61 vehicles. Again, that's a typical day. There may be days that are slightly higher, maybe days that are slightly less than that. The volume of traffic on Mitchell Road in the morning hour is approximately 200 vehicles, and in the evening hour about 240 vehicles. As part of this project, we projected the increase in traffic that would be generated not only from this proposed project, but all other pending projects that have received planning board approval, but have not completed the build-out of the particular project. And by projecting the traffic volume for this project and those projects, that added traffic was directed onto Mitchell Road as the existing traffic stream presented itself. And from that, we calculated what the capacity of the intersection, the critical intersection of Chevres and Mitchell Road was. And under the greatest loading, which would be all of the pending projects, as well as this project, projected to the year 1992, which was based on a 5% growth rate along Mitchell Road each year, the intersection will operate at the highest or the best level of service, which is level of service A.
Bill, if I might just ask, is that, did you say Chevres Road and Mitchell Road intersection?
That's correct.
Is level of service A?
That would operate at level of service A in 1992 under full build-out of this project and all the other pending projects along Mitchell Road, as well as increasing the base traffic, which was counted during 1990 by a 10% growth factor.
And that's with testimony of school buses waiting 8 to 10 minutes to get out onto Mitchell Road, which would doesn't seem to be the level of service A if that's a condition that exists.
Well, again, the traffic counts taken in the morning peak hour show a total of 46 vehicles coming out of Chevrolet on the Mitchell Road. And I could certainly find out exactly the length of time that it takes one to exit from Chevrolet on the Mitchell, but I was there both during the morning, the evening, noontime, weekend, and I never had a difficult situation in exiting on to Mitchell from Chevrolet. And usually when you calculate and you find level of service A operation, it certainly indicates that there isn't a problem in exiting. There's always a rare occasion that something may occur that the bus or another vehicle may have to delay in making the move, but when you have level of service A conditions, you do not have a delay problem.
Mr. Chairman, point of information, Bill, if you could you draw a distinction for the group here between level of service A and level of service B, just so that there's an understanding of what that means?
Yes, I apologize. I forget where I am sometimes. Capacity of an intersection is just like a report card in school. An A is the very best that an intersection can operate, and in general terms, E or F is the very worst that an intersection operates, or is often referred to as the capacity of the intersection. So in this case here, as I had indicated, we measured it and calculated it for the 1992 build condition, and the intersection operates at level of service A, and I might add it's not a borderline A, it's clearly level of service A. The only other issue that I recall was the safety issues along Mitchell Road, and as indicated in my report, there is an accident occurrence problem along Mitchell Road. In my opinion, it's certainly not one of volume, it's one of driver error. Of the 21 reported accidents that were reported by the Maine Department of Transportation for 1986 through 1988, 9 of the collisions involved excessive speed by the driver and poor roadway conditions, specifically icy and snow-covered roadways. Based on a review of some of the roadway conditions along Mitchell Road, I had indicated in the report that a comprehensive signing program be undertaken to update the signs along Mitchell Road to better inform the driver of the different traffic hazards that may occur along the roadway. Some of the other things that certainly would improve the safety along the roadway. In some areas, the signs are not visible because brush or bushes are blocking the signs totally. Some of the signs are faded and outdated and provide no reflectivity in the evening hours so that a driver during the nighttime wouldn't see that sign at all. Typically, a sign only lasts for about 7 years and they should be replaced after that, or the nighttime driver has no value in the sign at all because he cannot see that with his headlights. The other thing that appears to be a maintenance issue is that the double yellow center line, which is very critical in steering the driver around a curve, certainly appears that it is not done every year, or if it is, it needs to be done twice a year, because this time of year the pavement marking is non-existent. It would appear that an increased sanding and salting program during snow-covered roadway times would also improve the roadway conditions. And certainly speed enforcement along the roadway would help control the speeding problem. And in some places, it looks like some minor embankment work on the side of the road could help improve the sight distance around the curves. It can only be minor improvements because you would actually encroach upon people's yards and so forth. And the other thing that appeared to be a problem in some areas is on-street parking that occurs on the roadway, which forces a driver to use the oncoming travel lane to maneuver around in certain areas. That's another issue that I would recommend, that at least the parking be removed in the sharp curved areas along Mitchell Road. I think I've answered, maybe not specifically, but each of the issues that were raised.
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Edson?
I have several questions, but as I was listening to you, I think I missed a point in your report. You're talking a number of accidents, I think you said 9 out of 21 occurred in excessive speed and ice. And was that your point, that that was a high percentage? I took that there were 60% of the accidents took place in perfect conditions.
Well, again, it's any time that you have a number of traffic accidents occurring along a roadway segment or an intersection, you try to locate a pattern of whether it's speed or a pattern of people running off the road, or in some places in Cape Elizabeth there is a problem with vehicles striking deer, for example. You look for that pattern, and in this case the only pattern that really stood out in reviewing actual police records, which was done in this case, was the excessive speed and the bad roadway conditions.
I guess my question was, is it the 9 out of 21 that is a high percentage of poor condition, or is it the 12 out of 21
that is a high percentage? I apologize. The 9 out of 21, at least in my opinion, is a high number of roadway speed problems combined with the pavement conditions in the wintertime.
Does your accident count the two accidents from last summer?
No, it does not. It only includes 1986 through 1988, because at the time of the report, that's all the data was available through the state. Okay. The state takes a year to post the previous year's data.
How many days, actual days, did you take a manual count at that location?
There was a one-day count.
A one-day count?
That's
the entire report?
Yes, sir. That's the standard way of doing it. As indicated in the report, that traffic, after the counts were taken, that traffic was factored up to the 30th highest hour of 1990. By taking state statistical data, you can take any day of the year, any week of the year data, and factor that up to the 30th highest hour of the year traffic. So I may be a couple percent high, I'm not a
statistician, but it certainly seems that that's a low level of significance to take a one. So how many hours was the counter actually there?
2 hours in the morning and 3 hours in the afternoon. In both cases, we covered the peak hour, which is the important hour of traffic analysis. You cover the peak hours in both morning and the afternoon.
Okay. As a public engineer, or a professional engineer, I should say, if you were looking at the Chevres Mitchell Road intersection at the 1992, or maybe it's the current rate of 300 vehicles peak hour, AM and PM, is that the way you would design an intersection for that type of flow? With a sweeping curve?
Well, I guess it would be more appropriate to answer the question, is Mitchell Road designed according to good engineering design standards?
No, my question is specifically about that one intersection. Is that how you'd design it?
Under the conditions that's available along Mitchell Road, there's really not a whole lot more you could do other than tightening up the one sideline of Chevres Road. Other than that, there's really not a whole lot more you could do.
Can you make it a T-intersection where there's a three-way stop?
I would not recommend putting a three-way stop at that point, because you have two vehicles that would be approaching on Mitchell Road that would be basically blinded until they reach the stop sign, and you would increase the number of skidding accidents, I would assume, at the intersection significantly by doing
that. I'm not saying that that's the best design. I'm just saying we have probably a worse design situation now, and we're looking at loading more cars into that intersection. I think a four-hour study projecting for 4 or 5 years, well, probably a decade of what we're going to rely for information, that's certainly not a dependable study as far as I'm concerned as one board member. To spend 4 hours counting traffic on one day out of a year to make decisions upon.
Thank you. Any other questions of Mr. Bray? Mr. Chairman.
I thought I'd heard a comment earlier from someone in the audience that there was only one means of access onto Mitchell Road, and that was through Chevres. Is that indeed the case, or are there other avenues onto Mitchell Road?
It's a single entry into this particular subdivision.
On sheet 5 of 11. There's a location diagram in the lower left-hand corner that would appear to have, by going through various sections of the neighborhood, other ways out onto Mitchell Road. I don't know if that's so schematic that I'm misreading it, but...
I can answer that. There has been built in the Mantra Way development in the last couple of years,
be fair to say, however, that since that's on the inside of a curve, that's a very dangerous place to enter and exit onto Mitchell Road.
Without checking the actual field sight distance, it would be difficult to give you an exact opinion. If it is on the inside of the curve, your vehicle sight lines in both directions along Mitchell Road would be very, very important to at least examine to make sure that there is, in fact, adequate sight line to handle the traffic. The sight lines at Chevres are adequate to handle the posted speed limit along Mitchell Road.
I have one other question. At level service A, what length of time would one expect to have to wait to make a left-hand turn from Chevres onto Mitchell Road during the morning rush hour?
Should be very little waiting at all. It should be almost a continuous movement, making the left turn either in or out of the street.
Did you observe during your 4 hours of observation? Obviously, if one is observing a traffic situation on the 4th of July for 4 hours, let's say for a resort intersection, that's probably more valuable than 2 months in the dead of December. So in terms of the length of time that you observed it, did you observe in the morning any platooning of traffic, which although the intersection because of total daily flows might have been at level service A, any extraordinary delays because of platooning of traffic or traffic? I exit on Route 77 every morning, and it really depends upon your luck each day, whether you're caught sort of in the middle of cars that all remain equidistant apart and you can sit there for a couple of minutes, or if some guy's going ultra slow in a group, then you can cut out fairly easily. But at level service A, did you observe within level service A any platooning of traffic or any unusual traffic patterns that would at least indicate there might be significant delays, such as with a bus maneuvering?
I actually did not take the 5 hours. It wasn't four. It was 5 hours of counts myself. It was done by a technician. But I have been there during the peak hours. And in both times that I was there, I had no problem at all. I may have waited momentarily for a vehicle in front of me to either maneuver in or come out of the intersection, but it wasn't six, seven, eight, nine cars backed up at the intersection. Again, keep in mind that speed and volume of traffic are the two controlling values that you need in order to create a capacity problem. On Route 77, you have as many as 1,000 to 1,200 vehicles in that same morning peak hour that the 200 vehicles on Mitchell Road are trying to compete and find a gap in that traffic to get out. On Mitchell Road, at the intersection of Chevres, we have 57 vehicles on the side street and 200 vehicles on Mitchell Road. So again, there's a tremendous difference in the volume on Route 77 than there is on Mitchell Road.
In your opinion as a professional engineer, is there adequate access to, say, the middle of Mr. Drinan's property for emergency purposes, given what appears to be limited access from Mitchell Road?
Well, I have a little bit of a difficulty in responding to that type of a question. I think it would be better addressed by your local fire department and police department, as far as whether they feel comfortable with the the dead end street versus a connecting street. From a traffic standpoint, it does remove the chance of through traffic using that, and it basically would be confined to just local traffic, not traffic that may be connecting between, say, Spurwink and Mitchell if the roadway was connected all the way through.
Thank you.
Okay, we have a slight issue and problem tonight in that we had thought that we were going to be continuing the public hearing and considering another plan, as was expressed in the field, although we had encouraged Mr. Drinan to continue and required Mr. Drinan to continue with the plan that was submitted and posted for public hearing. In line with that, we also scheduled three other applicants for tonight. We have our requirement that we do stop discussion at 10 o'clock unless the board extends that. I might suggest and get a sense for the planning board what you would like to do. There are several still issues to be discussed. One of those is the sewering of the proposed project and the current issue before the town council, which this planning board will be presenting on May 21st before the council, to allow properties that are approvable for on-site waste disposal to be publicly sewered. Mr. Drinan alluded to that earlier with the unanimous vote of concurrence by the sewer board. There are issues of road standards and road widths. There are issues of interior design to the subdivision that are appropriate for a fairly lengthy discussion. And we could go on for the next 2 hours here talking about those issues. I would propose that at our June workshop, we take an hour and a half of that workshop evening to discuss specifically the requests that Mr. Drinan has made to us through his application for road standard design issues. We would invite the public to attend that workshop and to listen to the questions and comments by the planning board. And we take the time to adequately go over and address all of the concerns and issues that have been raised in public hearing or by the individual board members. So I would ask for your thoughts on a workshop item. We are trying to do that in the town of late, to use our workshop session to talk about one development proposal before us, and then reserving the end of that workshop for one particular planning issue of concern for that month. This would presumably, if you wanted to do that, be the issue of subdivision or site plan under review.
Mr. Chairman?
I
would like to make a motion that that we suspend any further discussion of this proposal at this time and table those discussions to our June 5th board meeting, workshop meeting, where we could get into some more details. And Mr. Drinan would come prepared at that meeting to discuss the issues you just enumerated.
Okay. Would it be more appropriate, and let me ask the question, to table this to our June 19th meeting, which is our next formal planning board meeting, and in the interim invite Mr. Drinan to our June 5th workshop meeting and members of the public to discuss this?
Yes, so I would agree with that.
Okay, there is an issue then, even with that June 19th, we are required after the public hearing closure to vote on a proposal unless there's concurrence between an applicant and a board to extend that further. Of course, June 19th is 30 days plus a few days, and before that motion is discussed, there's a point of order, and that is whether or not there's any concern about the June 19th date being beyond the 30 days. Didn't think so. I take that for the public record to indicate that you don't have any concern or problem with that.
I would like to be able to go to the June 5th workshop, discuss the issues raised here and any additional issues you may have, and I'd like to be able to continue on with the normal review process at your June 19th meeting. And I would like to waive, if that's what it requires from me, the necessity for you to take a vote on this at that meeting. This meeting, or whatever.
At this meeting, you mean, right?
The motion is to table until our June 19th meeting.
I second the motion.
It's been seconded. Any further discussion?
Was Mr. Drynan looking for any additional comments or requests from the board?
Point of order, Mr. Chairman, can we discuss after?
You're right. Only if there's a point of order that someone is raising about a motion to table.
So it would be inappropriate for me to request the location of 12-inch trees along the road right of way?
It would be.
Okay, I won't do that.
All those in favor of the tabling motion, please raise your hand. Opposed? It's a unanimous decision. See you on the 5th, and we will again take it up formally on the June 19th. Yes, sir.
I'd just like to make one comment out of context. In defense of the public works down at Cape Elizabeth, there was some comments made that we need new signs on Mitchell Road. There were brand new current warning signs placed on Mitchell Road last year right across from the Jordan property, which is probably the worst curb on Mitchell Road. They are brand new. The public works department did that. Also, in defense of our Cape Elizabeth Public Works Department, some remarks that were alluded about icy conditions on the roadway. That roadway, because of the school bus, is the best kept roadway that I think that there is in the South Fulton Cape Elizabeth area. As one fellow that has woken up every bad morning between 6:15 and 6:30, I can attest to it. It's sanded, it's plowed, and it is probably the best maintained road in our area. In defense of the Public Works Department, because of some remarks that were made by Mr. Gray, I appreciate your time.
Thank you, sir, and we'll take that in the context that it was offered, and that is to thank our Public Works Department for the excellent job that they've done, and not part of the public hearing process, so thank you very much. Thank you. We'll see you on June 19th and June 5th. The meeting will be on June 5th in Town Hall in the cafeteria at
7 o'clock.
7 o'clock.
Cafeteria being downstairs in the basement.
Good evening. Next item on the agenda is the Highlands at Broad Cove, Greater Portland Development Group, a 20-lot major subdivision. This evening's issues are preliminary plan review under Section 16.2.4, wetlands alteration permit under Section 19.3.9, and an amendment to the previously approved subdivision under Section 16.2.5. Are there representatives from Greater Portland Development Group? In terms of comments on the process while you're getting set up, this development plan has been before the board for some time. There have been a number of issues that have been raised and throughout the process. There may be some additional items that are discussed here tonight. Public hearing was held, was closed. The board indicated at its last meeting that it will be prepared to vote this evening on the proposed application. And that vote could take several forms. That might include approval. That might include approval with conditions. That may be denial of the application for subdivision approval. Before we start, the board has received one letter from Dr. D'Angelo, Southern Maine Neurological Associates, stationary, indicating his interest and concern for Broad Cove Highlands development. I believe all of the members got a copy of that letter in your packages, and I'm asking at this point if you did receive copies of the letter. Very good. That would be a part of the public record, a well-constructed letter indicating several concerns. Dated May 11th, 1990. With that, Mr. Kennedy, if you would, if you want to spend a couple of minutes backgrounding us on the changes that have occurred to your plan since the last time we talked, in March, I believe, and what you're proposing this evening that's different.
Okay. As you know, we have revised the plan.
And if you could identify yourself as you step up to the microphone.
My name is Peter Kennedy, president of the Greater Portland Development Group. As you know, we have revised the plan, giving more open space, or offering more open space to the land trust and providing some more public access ways throughout the property. I'll have Scott Decker run through the plan, if you like, and address the changes.
Very good.
Thank you, Peter. Mr. Chairman, members of the board, I'm Scott Decker from Squaw Bay Corp. As Peter mentioned at the last meeting, there were a number of issues that were raised by the board, and we feel that we have addressed those issues, and what I would like to do is just take a moment to highlight some of the major items. In the Phase 1 area on Lot 4, in this location here within the wetland area, there was a request by one of the board members that an easement be included across the wetland for drainage of any water stored behind the houses along Hunts Point Road extension. A 30-foot easement has been added to the plan. This will, in effect, provide two methods of draining water from behind these houses, either across the wetland.
Scott, if I could interrupt just for a moment, could you bring the drawing closer and out in front of the microphone? There are lights on it that make it impossible to see, at least from this vantage, and I think for members of the public as well.
That help any day?
Can all members of the board see that now? Okay. Members of the public see it. Good solution.
Help.
I'm sorry, continue.
Sure. What that does is provide two methods of draining the water from behind the houses here, either across the wetland, through the right-of-way, or through this easement, along the property line, and through the storm drainage system being proposed by the applicant under the Farm Pond Road. There was a request also for consideration to donate some of the wetland area in Phase 1 to an agency that would guarantee the protection of it in the future. The applicant has taken this section of wetland here and is planning to dedicate it in fee to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. What this will do, once we implement a pedestrian easement right here, will provide pedestrian access from Winding Way through to Farm Pond Road, through the wetland area and through this easement. There was also a concern that the neighbors group hydrogeologist had submitted a report stating that I believe 11 of the lots in the development would not pass the state test for nitrates at the property line. We've had John Seavey of Seavey Mahar Engineers prepare a letter report stating that with his analysis, all of the lots will pass the state test. And I might add that this development is also before the DEP, who is also reviewing that issue. There was a request that the page 3 of the HHE 200 forms be submitted, and they have been. They were in the packet. Concern for wildlife corridors. I believe it's been demonstrated previously that the primary wildlife habitat is the wetland areas. These are being preserved, and that in conjunction with the provision that there be no clearing within 15 feet of any of the property lines except for septic systems where they are noted within that 15-foot area, provide adequate wildlife corridors. There'll be a 30-foot strip of trees where there are trees now along these property lines. There was also a concern that there would be added flow to the area behind these houses on Pine Ridge Road. A review of the drainage calculations indicate that there is no significant increase in the peak rate of flow into this area. And I noted in the town engineer's letter, he has requested that the outlet to the drainage that we have shown going across to this easement be directed directly into the wetland area rather than over behind these houses. Now, although that's not shown on the plans that have been submitted, that can and would be taken care of. The one last issue I note is the screening of this house down here along Farm Pond Road at the intersection of Hunts Point Road Extension. We have provided some pine trees to be planted between the road and the house, and there is a request by the board that the center line of the road be offset 2 or 3 feet or whatever can be offset to provide more distance from the road to the house. I don't believe that offsetting 2 or 3 feet will make any significant difference, but during final design, if the board requests, that can also be implemented.
Any further presentation, Mr. Kennedy?
No, but we'd be glad to answer any questions you may have.
Okay. With the board's permission, I've got a couple of questions that I'd like to ask. A couple of them are for you, Mr. Kennedy. Some are engineering and some may be legal-oriented that you may wish counsel to answer. So with the board's permission, I'll start. We had talked previously about the road name, and if the board were to approve the subdivision this evening or subsequently, we had talked about the road going from Farm Pond Road to Jordan Farm Road. You had indicated you had no concern or problem with that, that the fire chief might, and he has indicated that he doesn't, and that's wholly up to you to decide. Do you have any concern or problem then with changing that name to Jordan Farm Road?
I do not have a problem with that.
Okay. The area that you have proposed in this meeting for the first time as a public walkway extends along a road that historically has existed on the site, the first road. I was out on the site this weekend looking at that proposed walkway, and for a portion of that walkway it is impossible to traverse that original roadbed. Plus it does take the future pedestrian across the site immediately adjacent to the rare plant stand that you've located on the site and on your plans. The fix to that kind of inaccessibility over the area that would be proposed to be dedicated to the land trust is to take the pedestrian up onto the new road for distance until that person can then get onto dry land and back onto the original roadbed. From walking the site and looking at the area, it would appear that would have to occur up to the point where your wetland extends upward, right about in there, yes, before you can get back down onto dry conditions.
What are your comments on that?
I felt that you could go along the, call it the new roadway, and then down over the hill prior to the wetland, and then immediately in this thick wooded portion of that old roadway. That it's pretty much drawn to scale here. It's just hard to see because it is 100 scale. It's about 50 to 75 feet away from the rare plants sightings.
Okay, so it would be on the uphill side, not on the original roadbed that exists on the property, which is very wet.
Well, there are two roadways.
I understand. One's right. An original, one's a newer one. You're proposing to use the newer roadbed for your driveway
correct.
System.
Correct. And then have the walkway peel off of that into the original location.
Okay. You show on the map, though, it appears as though the dotted line is along the old, the historical roadbed, the one that's always existed there. In fact, it's identified in the more westerly portion of the site as
yes.
the existing old former roadbed. Do you have any concern with bringing that walkway up and off that roadbed onto dry, passable ground and away from those rare plants?
In this area, no.
Yes, okay.
Right in here, no.
Very good. A couple of engineering questions. Drainage, and we have our town engineer, Bob Hunter, here this evening, specifically to answer any board comments or questions that we might have. The drainage for Pine Ridge Road at the public hearing indicated that there was some concern about the addition of stormwater flow to that. The engineer, town engineer, has reviewed that, has suggested some fixes. Mr. Decker has indicated that those fixes are appropriate from your standpoint as the applicant. But the testimony, and that's good. The issue is how much more stormwater is going to run onto the adjacent properties on Pine Ridge Road. Your own submission indicates, and I'm not understanding all of the engineering words or how to express between cubic feet per second or acre feet of water, indicated that there would be, during a storm event, up to 1 inch of water on some properties, but that wasn't identified where that might be. Either yourself or perhaps your engineer might further define that for the board.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, the difference in the numbers is basically the difference between the peak flow and the total volume of water. What we're stating is that the peak rate of runoff, the computer analysis that we've used indicate that there will be no increase in the peak rate of runoff. So it's, I guess it's reasonable to assume that there will be a minor increase just due to building rooftops and so forth, but it's an insignificant rate of increase. However, there will be some additional runoff just due to the impervious area. And what we're saying is that if you were to assume that the outlet to this area, this wetland area, were plugged and no flow were allowed to leave, then the amount of water, the amount of increase in water, would be less than 1 inch rise in this ponded area.
Would that be off-site or on-site if that were to occur?
Well, it's going to be both.
As a representative of the applicant and standing here before us, before the subdivision is acted on, there are residents who live at the end of Pine Ridge Road. They have expressed concern for additional stormwater flow onto their properties. Your analysis is, state for the record what your analysis on behalf of the applicant is for those residents. Are they going to experience any additional stormwater coming onto their property?
In my opinion, no.
Okay. We might ask Mr. Hunter those questions a little bit later as well and assure ourselves from our standpoint. Next question I have, and I don't think we should forget that, and we'll ask Mr. Hunter later. Next question is on the new Jordan Farm Road bend. where the ditch and culvert system brings water from the back of the properties that front on Hunts Point Road Extension down into the drainage swale, the new ditch that you propose running from Jordan Farm Road to the corner of the property. If you can identify where I'm talking about, Scott.
Say that again.
It's that east-west thing that we were talking about last time, right in there.
Right in there.
Yeah. Could you tell us, and it was a little unclear for laymen sitting on the board, the culvert that goes underneath that road, what elevation that is, and the ditch that comes out of that culvert, how that's going to be configured and what it will look like.